ladies and gentlemen, children of all ages, theys and thems, without further ado, look, this is somebody that both of us are probably sad and a little bit apprehensive and scared to say that we've known each other for over 20 years now. It's been 20 years now, man. This is Tony Lovato, the lead singer from Mest. And thank you for being here today. I truly appreciate you, bud. Where are you coming back from? You said you were just coming back from somewhere. What were you up to today?
Running some errands, adult shit, and moving into a new place. So just driving through some neighborhoods and shit.
Well,
adulting,
and we'll get to what it's like to be a rad dad in just a little bit. Let's set the tone. All right, you're a young kid growing up in Chicago. You play drums. You're into some bands, and then 1995 comes around. And what are you guys doing? Trying to? You didn't know Good Charlotte. You didn't know those guys back then. But do you and Matt, your cousin, just pick up some instruments and start playing, or was there some kind of a talent show that you needed to do, or were you trying to get laid? What was the deal? You're in high school and you want to be in a band. How do you get there?
In high school,
I think we lost him. Tony, you there, bud? Oh, I think we lost him. Oh, Discord.
You hear me?
Yeah, I can hear you now, buddy. I can hear you now. There you go.
Sorry, let me get to a better spot that I currently stay in. So 95 comes around, barely in high school. My high school career was pretty short. And it was, I'm trying to think if I even started the band when I was in high school. We might have actually started when I was already, I think I was already kicked out. So I was, technically, I got kicked out like 3 months into my sophomore year, 15. Because I know our first show was October of 95. So I think I was like on the brink of getting expelled. Me and my cousin and my brother had different bands growing up. Since we were like the first shitty little band we started, I think I was 7 years old.
Oh man, that's early. That's really early to start a band, dude.
Yeah. And my brother was nine, my cousin was nine also. And we would play like Judas Priest covers of
awesome.
Rolling Stones, like shit that like the old man had around the house,
right.
Like that type of stuff.
Well, that's what you get into, right? You either older brothers or what your parents have around. That's how you explore and find new music, right?
Right. Yeah. I mean, that's essentially, you know, whatever. That's how you, you know, whatever's being given to you, so to speak.
Or porn. You know, you find the dad's porn. That's how you get into that as well.
Not at seven. That was more like around the age of like nine. Started the band. We've just gone through a couple different bands and. Right around 95, like there was a lot of older, I live in a pretty generational neighborhood where I grew up, where it was like, you know, you knew family names, it was like there were generations of families. And so the older brothers, you know, the older kids in the neighborhood, a lot of them listened to like Religion, Social Distortion. There was like The Clash, the punk rock stuff.
So good.
And we had, you know, Naked Ray Gun in Chicago, Peg Boy, and, you know, some pretty big punk rock band in Chicago too. And so it was just, you know, you would just get music from your elders.
Yeah.
And I think, you know, that was Green Day had broken out at that point, but I listened to a lot of like Pennywise back in the day, and Operation Ivy, Rancid, Let's Go record.
Pop Ive is one of my favorite all time.
Oh yeah, for sure,
dude. I mean, come on, such a great album. If you've never heard Operation Ivy, I highly recommend that you go out there and do that. Because, like, literally every pop punk or punk band that I like somehow grabbed something from what Operation Ivy was doing at the time and said, oh, I'm going to grab onto this and take it. Now, I did promise everybody, before we get too far into it, I did promise everybody so that you don't have to do it, because I know at some point people are already asking. They know about you. They know about the band. But everybody asked this, and I knew you hate answering. It. Where did the band name come from? All right, so they're young, right? They're a bunch of hooligans, as my grandmother might call them, a motley crew. It is Milwaukee's Best. That's what it's short for. It's not Messed Up Kid or anything like that. It's short for Milwaukee's Best. That is where the name Messed comes from. Okay, chat, there you go. You've heard it here first. That's a more you know moment. Now we can all move on. And so as you start this band, how do you get noticed around Chicago being a bunch of young, dumb punk kids? Are you going into the city and playing shows or whatnot? What can you do besides playing in your garage?
Well, there was a pretty good, punk rock scene happening in that era. Skater punks, ska bands. And so we had a little club on the south side in a town called Off the Alley, which was the punk rock club there that you'd play shows at. That was like the cool venue to play. Probably held like 200-300 kids.
Yeah.
And then there was Fireside Bowl, which is pretty legendary. That was on the north side.
I've heard of that place. Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, it's legendary. And so that was the south side, north side. But then this was back in the day when we would get together with bands and rent out, BFW halls.
Yes, that's how it all, right? You'd get together with a bunch of bands, you'd rent out a hall, set up your merch booth. That is ground zero for bands, man. I love that.
Sure.
I love that.
I mean, we were doing that shit with, I'm sure you've heard of the Plain White Tees, like they were a little band at the time.
Hey,
like,
there, Delilah.
There's another band called AYA who eventually turned into Show Off, I'm sure you've heard of.
Yep.
We would just get together. So I could connect with other bands and you'd go to shows and then meet the other bands that you didn't know and then put a show together with those bands. And, I remember going to see a show at I think it was a Hardee's or like some sort of like restaurant.
Howard Johnson's, dude. What were you doing?
Yeah, I mean, anywhere and everywhere where you could play a show, we would do
you
it.
Would you would do know, it. And all ages shows were really important, right? I'm assuming. So you had to go. If a venue was like, yeah, we'll allow your kids to come in here. You're like, boom, sign me up, right?
Yeah, I mean, it was because at that point, too, it was a whole brand new generation of kids. We were young,
right.
There wasn't really the over 21 crowd. I mean, I'm sure there was that generation, but we were part of a whole new scene that was starting, our generation, should I say. And so, we would play. And then there was an earlier skate park that was not too far from the house. So then we talked to that guy and started doing shows. We'd play inside the half pipe and those shows were fucking big and rad. It was just, connecting with the other kids who like punk rock, the skate kids and stuff like that in the community. And then you put on shows and I was just the type of kid to really, really hustle back then.
Uh-huh.
Like looking back now, probably was a little bit of an annoying kid too, but you had to be doing it. I was the one that would go to every show of bands I liked and hawk CDs on stage and wait to meet the bands afterwards and give the band CDs. And I mean, essentially
that's how you got noticed though, right? Was doing that handoff, that literally hitting the sidewalk, hitting the pavement. Now, bring us up to that. Who did you give I know who it is, but if they don't know, who did you give that demo to? Was it this demo I'm holding in my hand? Dead End. Is it this demo? And whose hand did you put it in?
I don't know if it was. There were some songs from that made it to our first CD that we did on our own. But I think at this point we had already had our 17 song CD, the More Money, More 40s one. That was pretty punk ska. But I went to a Goldfinger show where they were doing like the surprise two shows at Fireside Bowl, one morning, one at night. We heard about it, went down there, and I had met John Feldman previously, singer of Goldfinger, previously at a Goldfinger show, and would always hassle him and, we'd love to open up for you guys, this and that, blah, blah, blah. And he had said, next time we're in town, you guys can open for us. So this was now the next time they were in town. And I'm like,
you called about it.
Show, I had to go up to him and I said, hey, man, you said next time you get to play in town, we could open up for you. Grant Shoff was opening for them. And I think he was already working with them at that point. He goes, hey, man, and I didn't know him. I was just a kid that when he came to Chicago, I took the fuck out of him. But just me going, hey, you said we could do this, blah, blah, blah. So, what's up? And he was like, here, man. He's like, you got to be able to keep in touch with me. grabs a pen and paper, writes down his home phone number, goes, here, just keep in touch with me next time we're coming into town.
Who does
that? Give me a call and let me know.
Who does that shit, man? That's awesome, right?
And so, like, I just couldn't believe it. And everybody's like, what just happened? And I'm like, I don't know. You gave me this number.
I think I'm going steady with John. You're right, you know?
Yeah. And so, yeah, I mean, it was that. And then, I remember I was at a party, and this kid comes up to me from the neighborhood. He goes, hey, I'd like to call me out. Hey, I heard you were opening up for Goldfinger next time they're in town. And I said, well, yeah, I mean, that's what John said. And he goes, well, they're coming to town next month. And I go, are they really? And he's like, yeah. And I'm like, oh, I didn't even know. He told me to call him. I'm like, I'm going to call him. Like, he was trying to, like, talk shit.
Yeah, he was trying to call you out on your shit, basically. And
right.
then you were like, hold on a second. I've got a golden ticket.
Right. So I took the fucking golden ticket and I turned it in. I called him up. He answered his phone. I mentioned, he goes, okay, here, call John Reese, who was his manager.
Right.
And got a hold of John and then talked to John. John talked to my old man. We set it up. And then next thing you know, we were opening up for Goldfinger.
All right. Then you open up for Goldfinger at the House of Blues. And then down the road, John brings you into Maverick, right? Is that how it worked, which was owned by Madonna at the time? Madonna's label, Maverick, is that how that happened? I don't want to, because I do have a question that I think that people will really want to hear about. But how did we get from opening up for Goldfinger to being signed by a major label?
Right, so it didn't happen immediately. Like, we played that show, and granted, like, we were able to really impress him because what I started doing and what I told the band, what I wanted to do was, I said, let's concentrate on just writing to the song. I said, if we can play a show once a month, every other weekend, let's play eventful shows. I don't want to be playing constantly where it's boring. Like, let's become the band that people want to go see, and we're not oversaturating our one fucking market that we have.
Right.
That's so strategic sort of thing, which you do in this day and age too. As a professional band, you can't oversaturate a market.
Right. Once you get to a certain point where you're at, and you got to slow down, right?
Right. So, and the whole band at this point is like, dude, nothing's going to happen. I was like, I don't know. We've already opened up for him, you know? Like, he said to keep writing songs. And so I always had this plan in my head anyways. And a couple of months had passed, and I, you know, you don't know. Everything's up in you. But I'm keeping my fucking positive thoughts out there.
Right.
I'm sitting at my girlfriend's house at the time, like 18 years old, maybe 18 years old. Yeah, 18 years old. And her phone rings at 2 a.m. Your mom answered it. She goes, hey guys, somebody's on the phone for Tony. And it was probably midnight in California, so 2 a.m. in Chicago. And I answered the phone. I'm like, hello. And he's like, hey Tony, it's John Feldman. And I'm like, oh, what's up, man? And he's like, you still got a band? You still got Mess? And I said, yeah, man, we're still writing songs, still playing shows. Okay, cool, man. So I'm wrapping up this show off record, and I talked to Guy O'Theory, and I told him about you guys, showed him some songs. So, because John talks fast as fuck all the time, it's always like, I should say he's always in 10, 11. And he's like, in a couple months, we're going to fly you guys out here and record some demos.
That's
and
awesome.
And I was just like, okay, right. Cool, man. Sounds
so
good.
That actually brings us to my next question. That's what I wanted to talk to you about. How did the creative process change from you guys just being a bunch of f***ed up kids in Chicago, right? I think it's funnier when I beep swears anyways. Just being a bunch of kids in Chicago making records on your Tascam or whatever it is, to being in a studio with these people, what were the expectations like? How did you not literally just freak out and go around and touch everything? Like, how did you not be the kid in this world, because at this point you got to be like, holy fuck, what is happening in my life? Look at what's going on, right?
Yeah, I mean, undoubtedly it was a very, very fucking exciting time.
Yeah.
But we had already been in what people would consider real studios at this point, because we could save up our money and go. But it wasn't like, I think even when we did our the best recordings we could do when we recorded, like, Mo Money recordings, we're in a real studio, but it was still fucking tape to tape. Pro Tools didn't even exist yet.
Yeah, that's right. It's all tape to tape. Now, if you guys want to, just so you know, John, the last thing that John just produced was Avril Lavigne's album that just came out. So think about this. You're hanging out with somebody that like is your, you know, you see as a mentor, you look up to him, and B, this dude's helping you out, and now he's helping you create music, right?
Right. I mean, yeah, and I was always a massive Goldfinger fan too, so it was, that was the weirdest thing. Is like, now I'm working with this guy, and here's, let me make the story even more weird. So this is okay. So then you had the years previous to having any contact with John, where we would go in and record own songs and put it, we're doing everything in the room. But on the way to the studio, I would always have this weird little daydream, like a fucking overthinker daydreamer, where I would have these thoughts in my head that we were going into the studio to work with John. And this is when John wasn't even a producer yet. He had worked with Show Up, nothing, just because I liked Goldfinger, I liked the tone and the production of their records. So I just always had this weird, it'd be cool if I was going to studio work with John. He wasn't even a producer yet. Cut to like 2 years later, I'm in the studio with John. He's an A&R guy from Maverick, and he's a producer now. So I don't know how I manifested these weird thoughts that of shit that wasn't even really happening yet in life into my real life. So that was even more of a trip to go back and think about, like, I used to like daydream about this, and I made these stories up in my head, and here I am. You know, like, that was really fucking weird.
Yeah, that's got, well, it's got to be, and that's one of the things I wanted to talk to you about today, because for everybody who's out there listening right now, you've had hopes and dreams, and it was something that Tony said that I wanted to point out, because something that I say, when the band was like, hey, nothing's going to happen, and you were like, no, we got to keep going, we got to keep writing songs, something I always tell everybody, the one thing that I can guarantee you in life is if you do nothing, nothing will happen. So if you don't want to progress yourself as a person, an artist, or whatever it is in life, I can guarantee you this, if you do nothing, no one's gonna come into your living room and hand you a record contract or a Twitch partnership or whatever it is that you want to succeed with in life. No one does it for you. You have to do it yourself. All right, so now you're getting bigger. What's your first tour like? People don't talk about what touring is really like. Everybody's like, oh, you went on tour. Oh my God, you're on tour. Look, touring is hard work. It's a lot of fun. It is a lot of fun. But until you get to where Tony ends up being at a certain point and having Guns N' Roses tour manager in Japan, until you get there, there is a long haul from being on the road to being the Rolling Stones on the road, okay?
Yeah, I mean, that's... And here's the thing. It is hard, but it is also obviously a lot of fun, especially when you're at the age that we were at, right? I was 19 years old when I got signed, started touring when I was still not legal to drink. I think I was 20 the first time we started touring. So we were doing the van tours, you know, and we did those nonstop. And I mean, for years. And I mean, to the point that we got put on a Goldfinger tour, I think summer of 2001. We got put on very late, last minute type of thing. So we couldn't even find a 15 passenger van to tour in. The only thing we could rent was a 7-passenger minivan. So we had 8 people in a 7-passenger minivan in the dead of summer.
What did you call yourselves, Fugazi at that point? Jesus, man.
Luckily, I had a lot of Xanax on me at the time. And that was how everybody got to sleep. Because we all had to sleep sitting up every night. So it was like, I would hand them out every night. We'd take some, go to sleep. But I mean, at the same time, still the best times of your life. You know, you're a kid, you get to get on stage in front of 1,000, 2,000 people every night. You're playing shows, you're drinking with your friends. You're living the dream. You may not be making money, but you're living the dream and you're able to eat, you know, and that's... But yeah, I mean, it was years and years of doing that. So we got to the point of becoming successful enough to then be in a tour bus, to then be having a bunk to sleep in, and you know what I mean?
Yeah, making having your own bunk. And man, I've been on the road with you where we were in campers. And you know what? My friend and one of the legends of the industry, Jerry Only, still to this day for the most, I don't know if the last few tours because Danzig was there and whatnot, but Jerry Only would always grab the nice campers, don't get me wrong, but he was always grab a camper because he said, you know what? It keeps ticket prices down. I've been on a bus with you as well. And by the way, that's the other thing about buses is you can get a bus from the 70s, kids. You know, just because you're on a tour bus doesn't mean that bus rolled off the rack at 2022, okay? You could be riding a tour bus that literally the Allman Brothers were just smoking weed in 40 years ago, and you can still smell it, you know?
For sure. That was our first tour bus was when we toured with Blink, and it was fucking terrible. Like, the air conditioning didn't work in it. Like, it was, it wasn't fucking anything to write home about, I'll tell you that.
And well, and you're touring with Blink, and they're a bunch of kids too. What's the craziest prank you can remember from those early tours?
We have some pretty brutal stories. And you know what's funny is I was with Scotty and Dennis from Lefty last night, who we did a bunch of tours with them back in the day. And Dennis, he plays in Face to Face now, and Scotty runs his foundation, Living the Dream. Actually has another one now too. The craziest shit would be the last day of tour. You'd always fuck around with each other.
Right.
Usually it was an onstage prank because that was when you were most vulnerable.
I've been part of one of these and it was fun. You keep going.
Yeah. And so I would say probably the craziest shit that in this day and age would probably get us in a tad bit of trouble. Goldfinger fucked around with us, and I can't remember what they did, but we got to get them last because they were headlining. And we grab a wicker basket, like, serving tray from the dressing room. Me and Nick go out on stage. I just bend down, get low enough. He faces the crowd and just shits on the wicker basket. And then I just leave it, and I set it down on the stage and leave it there. And nobody wanted to go grab the wicker basket, so it stayed up there for a while. And that was at the TLA in Philly. And to this day, like, I went back there and played there a couple of years ago.
And no wicker baskets about, like, for you.
Yeah, it's still talked about to this day that it was like the craziest fucking thing they've ever seen. Like, we always had to step it up a notch. Like,
we were
like the Jackass kids.
So my story from being out with you guys was when the Ritalin kids had to leave tour. This is nothing. We're out in Long Island or some shit. And we all went on stage. I remember we're sitting there and everybody's like, come on, come on. It's their last song. And we systematically started breaking down the drummer's kit as he was playing it and passing it into the audience. So now you see tour managers going, fuck you, and jumping into the crowd. They're literally flipping us all off as they jump into the crowd to try to get the drummer's kit back, and the kit is now riding the crowd like it was stage diving and shit, and the tour managers are just like, oh, come on, man, come on, and we're all just sitting there laughing our asses off, drinking Red Bulls and vodka going, look at that guy.
That's, you know, that just reminded me of another good one, because you said putting it into the crowd. Another good prank we did was to our one of our techs, who's still one of my best friends growing up. I actually just talked to him, caught back up with him like 3 weeks ago when I was quarantined because I had COVID. So it was his birthday. So we bring him out on stage, have the crowd sing him birthday. And as soon as he's standing there all happy, paying attention to the crowd, we fucking grapple him to the ground, hog tie him, put a fucking pillowcase over his... No, we didn't do a pillowcase. We just took duct tape, put it over his mouth and his eyes, hogtied him, threw him into the crowd, and played a full entire song with him being crowd surfed around the thing. At the end of the song, they finally bring him back up. And I remember talking to him afterwards. He was like, I was so discombobulated. I had no idea where I was at in the crowd. He's like, I was so fucking lost. And it was one of the funniest things to see one of your friends hogtied.
Right?
Duct tape over the eyes, duct tape over the mouth, can't see, and just being tossed around. It was fucking, it was amazing.
That is absolutely crazy. Now, I have a question for you. This is something I've always wanted to ask you. I never have. Now, when is throughout the years, whenever you introduce me to somebody that I've never met before that's in, you know, the music scene or whatever, you always preface this, and I want you to explain why. I know why, but you've always prefaced it with, hey, this is Logan, one of the cool radio guys from back when we, from back in the day. You always have to say, this is a, when you say radio guy, you always have to mention to everybody that you're introducing me to, a cool radio guy. So talk to me about the shitbags in radio. Just give me an idea of why you, as when you introduced me to like the lead singer of, you know, I don't know, it doesn't matter, but you, you introduced me to somebody and you're like, a cool radio guy. Why do you always feel like you had to preface it with that?
Well, I mean, I think that, and as you know, but most people don't, when it comes to radio and the music business in general, it's just a very political world. When you have something to offer or your song's on the radio, then when you go into the studios, everybody acts like, you know, you're the fucking God's gift and they're nice to you and they give a shit about you and they'll have you on the station and, you know, they're catering to you and then they're acting, you know, like your friends. But with you, it was like, we were never really a radio band, but no matter what, you always supported us as much as you could. Obviously, there's still politics involved, even at your station, where there's a playlist that you're given and you have to play these certain songs.
The most songs in a day, Tony, was 77. The most songs that we ever played in a day was 77. Can you believe that, Chip?
Right. So, like, I just remember every time we'd come through Hartford, we always had, if not the full radio station support, we had support from you where you were at least sneaking in a couple plays for us, mentioning shows,
always
giving us support no matter what, even though we weren't a radio band.
Yeah.
So you were going out of your way for us when the station probably wouldn't even want you doing this because we weren't in band. We weren't, you know, the label wasn't paying the station fucking money to play our shit. So, like, there's just a difference when you meet people that are genuine in their job.
Right.
And me being the guy who has been in the business long enough to see the fakeness, it was easy to identify somebody who just genuinely gave a shit and was there to help.
Yeah, you know what? I really love the music. I love you guys. We had the same sense of humor. And you know what? The same kind of thing happened with me when I befriended Dave Mira. I met him on the radio, right? And then we met each other in person at dinner that night. He happened to be at the same restaurant I was. And then he jokingly says to me, Tony, he goes, hey, we're painting my living room at this new condo tomorrow afternoon at noon if you want to swing by. So at noon, I left the radio station and I went over and I started helping him paint his living room, and we get done and he goes, never in a million years did I think you would be here to paint your living room. I go, Dave Mira asked me to paint a living room. I'm here, bro.
Right. Right.
And that's how we became friends. I just sat there and told jokes. And you know what's funny is I remember being out on the road with you and I got to ride on Goldfinger's bus for one leg of one point because I started doing my stand-up routine at the venue, and somebody from the band, I don't remember who it is because we were all drinking at that point, and it was like, ah, come on the bus, you know, we need, I, you can't,
I had to guess.
Yeah, I would get, yo, it was, that's exactly who it was. Yeah, you know what, now that you say it, it's gotta be. He's like, oh, this can't stop. But I had so much fun with you guys over the time that we've hung out. You know what, one of my biggest disappointments, man, I didn't take a lot of pictures. I wasn't a picture guy. I also thought it kind of put you on like a weird level. Like, you know, I always tell people, if you meet somebody famous and you want to connect with them, ask them about their favorite sports team. Don't start talking about anything else with them.
Right.
You know,
have a normal conversation.
Yeah. Have a normal conversation with them. And I got in radio, when you get fired, they usher you out. Because they think you're gonna, all of those people who locked themselves in radio stations in the 60s when they got fired and shit, they ruined it for the rest of us. So there was a picture of Tony and I at the Webster Theater. It was a great picture of both of us. And the only picture I had, and it was on my desk, and those motherfuckers wouldn't let me back in to get it. So now I've got a picture of me, Jer, and my friend Katie and her friend that's up right here in the corner next to my reminder of Dave Mira's wedding. So I've got you right over here, buddy, and then a couple a couple other acts that I worked with and toured with over there.
Yeah, and taking pictures wasn't as we didn't have front camera phones back.
We didn't have
wasn't accessible.
Exactly, like you know, not everybody had a camera, which is, you know, absolutely fantastic. I do want to. So one of the other things I want to talk to you about. I know one of the biggest moments for you was a moment that I happened to be a part of, not necessarily a part of it, but I was there. And I did the stage announcement for it. And
D. Snyder?
Yeah, D. Snyder, baby. I'm still here. And can you hear me, Tony?
Yeah.
Okay. So we're at 104 Fest, and they send me up to put my friends messed on stage because at this point we had been hanging out a lot, and I do this huge opening, and Tony's sitting eating a sandwich on the side of the stage, and he just smiles at me, and, like, I've got the crowd going crazy. At that, the vice president of Clear Channel came up to me as I left the stage and said that was one of the best stage announcements ever. And Tony's off stage eating a sandwich, looking at me, going, "Fuck off! I'll get up there when I want to." And I'm laughing. But then you got to do a song with D. Snyder. Talk about how that came about and what that actually meant for you. And then talk about, meeting Billy Joe Armstrong for the first time or the second time or however you want to. What's it like meeting the people that you truly, truly look up to? And thank you for the raid, That Gamer Mom. We've got Tony Lovato from MEST right now. We're doing an interview.
So, that D. Snyder thing was a little strange how it all came about. We were doing the fest, like you said, which was also a part of the Pop Disaster Tour that year.
Yep.
In Hartford, at least it was. I don't know. I got my phone rang, and I think I got a voicemail first. I got a voicemail from somebody from my label saying, "Hey, you're going to get, somebody's going to be calling you from a different number. Just answer it when they call." So I fucking answer the phone, and it's, "Hey, Tony, it's D. Snyder." And I'm like, "Fuck." And he's like,
"It's D."
And I think his son was even possibly hosting shit on MTV2 at the time.
Yeah,
I think.
His son was. He was developing his band at the time, and he was hosting stuff on MTV2. Yep.
Yeah. And he's like, "I know you guys are playing this fest next week. My son's a fan of the band." I don't even know if his son was or if he was just trying to fucking coat my balls a little. He goes, "But, it'd be great if I could come out on stage and we could play We're Not Gonna Take It." And I was just like, "Of course, absolutely."
How do you say no to that, right?
Right. And what's fucked up, and this goes to show how unprofessional we were as a band back in the day. So we knew we had to do that in like a month. Then we're heading out on the road for a month before we hit that stop.
No,
and
Tony.
We never learned the song. So the day of, we're like, "Well, fuck, we've got to learn this song." So we sat in the back of the bus and had to learn the song, you know, a couple hours before we go on stage and play this song. And I think Jeremiah pussied out. He didn't even do it. Trying to think of his name, the guitarist of the Riddling Kids. He actually, because we were on tour with them at the time, he loved D. Snyder and Twisted Sister. So, and he already knew the song. We're like, "Cool, well, that helps." So he came up and played it. But I remember we weren't even close to being done with our time yet either. This was the weird part. But then all of a sudden we get the word, "Hey, D. Snyder's on the side of the stage. He wants to play the song now." And we're all, "Well, yeah, but we've got like 3 songs left." And they're like, "Yeah, but he wants to do it now." And we're like, "Well, what the fuck?" So we give in.
Well, he's D. Snyder at a certain point. Other people were always like, "Well, he's acting like a rock star." Guess what? He's a fucking rock star.
He is a rock star. Sure.
You know, what do you want? Thank
you, sir. So D comes on. We play the song. Crowd goes nuts. But then when we were done with that song, there was then a time gap before the next band went on because there was time slots. And we were the only band at that festival. I think there were 15 bands before the Pop Disaster Tour, before that show actually started. But we were the only band where the fucking crowd was chanting for an encore, which was rad. And then from what I had heard, rumors got around. And whether or not this is true, it's just what I heard was that, like, everybody was talking and they were like, "You guys stole the show."
Oh, yeah.
That day over every band, even Blink and Green Day, like, everybody was talking about MEST.
So,
at that show, and I was like, "That was fucking
You're absolutely right. So later on, before you get to Green Day, let's pause right there, because later on that day, I'm hammered after hanging out with Sugar Colt for a little bit, because they had a bottle of Jack Daniels on the van, and Tim didn't want it traveling with him. So it was up to Aaron and I to finish that. So I'm hammered hanging out with Dee Snider, right? And Clear Channel, the people who are running the venue, Chris Jarris, is like, don't lose Logan. And Dee's like, I got him. Don't worry about it. And we're sitting on the side of the stage watching Blink 182, and Dee Snider looks down at me and goes, you know, except for that drummer there, these guys aren't much for musicianship, but boy, do they know how to put on a hell of a show. And in a drunken stupor, I look up at Dee Snider and I go, coming from a dude who once filed down his teeth, that is an immense compliment. And he laughed his ass off. And that was Dee. He was always good to me. Now, you are a huge Green Day fan. Is the world not a huge Green Day fan at this point? What was that like? How did you get to meet Billy Joe? What was that like? And I know you've met him more than once. Do you stay in touch with him?
So I don't stay in touch with Billy Joe, because we're not friends like that.
Right.
He definitely acquaintances. He knows who I am and knows the band Mastin. Met him on multiple occasions. I'm trying to think if this was the very first time that I had met him. Probably, but so we're standing on the side of the stage watching Green Day, and they're doing the part of the show where they call people up from the crowd to come play instruments. And everybody starts, I start like walking out on stage a little bit, and I'm looking back, and it's like all the Good Charlotte guys, Unwritten Law, Sugar Cult, and they're all looking at me, and everybody starts smiling like, dude, fucking do it. And so I start to like walk out a little bit, and Timmy Chunks, their guitar tech, looks over at me and he goes, don't fucking think about it. And I was like, all right. So I take a couple steps back, and then all of a sudden, Timmy Chunks ain't looking anymore. And I'm thinking to myself, and I'm hammered at this point too, obviously. And I'm thinking, when am I ever going to get this opportunity again? And what's the worst that can happen?
Right.
So I run out on stage, put my arms around Billy Joe, and I go, hey, I can play. And he goes, okay. And points me over to Mike. Mike Stearns puts his bass guitar on me and shows me the notes to play. And I played, I think it was Knowledge. I think that's the song you play during that part. And so I remember playing that part. And then they made us jump off the stage and stage dive. And then, so then I'm coming back around and I go to go back in. And then there was security waiting for me. That was part of their team, obviously. And they said, nope, you're done. You got to go. And I was like, fuck. So I did get kicked out, but then as I'm getting escorted out, right before everybody's gone, I run into Brian, who was one of the main guys who ran all that shit in the stores. Brian ran. There was the Teal stage and the Brian stage in the early days of Warped Tour. So I knew Brian. Brian used to work down in San Diego, one of the clubs that we'd play. So Brian knew me, knew the different acquaintances of friends, and knew that I wasn't being, you know, wasn't trying to be an asshole, wasn't, you know. And he goes, hey, man. He's like, come here. And he was like, that was pretty stupid. And I was like, I know. I was like, but I had to, dude. And he's all, here you go. And he gives me another pass. He goes, don't get caught. He goes, you can come back in. I was backstage in the fucking Green Day dressing room at one point. You know, like, I just put my hood up and my hat on and just sort of kept low-key the rest of the show and shit. But, yeah, I mean, that was my... And I don't know if there's video anywhere of that or photos, but that would be the fucking coolest thing to have, man. Like,
right?
If it happened in this day and age, there'd be videos everywhere.
Oh, there'd be videos of it everywhere. I used to be a tour manager for a band called Five Wise, and we were doing a college show, and they were playing a fraternity, and it's like, you know, a 4-hour show or whatever, and the guitarist starts playing Sabotage, and the lead singer comes over and he looks at me, I'm stage managing, and he's like, do you know the lyrics to this? I go, yeah, I do. We proceeded to do a 20-minute version of that shit, and you know what? It was on a cassette tape, and that cassette tape doesn't live anywhere anymore. And if it happened in this day and age, I would be paying people to have that taken off of the internet, right? You know? Oh man. All right. I know you've been on long. You've been on a real long time, and I appreciate that. We are going to show your latest video when all of this is said and done. And I want you to talk about a couple things. As we've gotten older, look, we've known each other for a long time. And one thing on a personal note, I'm just going to do this on the air. the last time I saw you, we hadn't seen each other in a number of years. I think it was, I had said it was like 10 years, but I think it was like 13 years. And I was a little bit nervous because we hadn't seen each other. We had texted each other, maybe a phone call here or there, bless you. But we hadn't actually seen each other. And what I loved was that the fact, and you do this for everybody that I've ever seen you interact with. It's just like the last time that you saw me. We took up right where we left off. And I really appreciated that about you. And I remember sitting outside and a lot of fans coming up to you, talking to you, probably the same way that you talk to John from Goldfinger and Billy Joe from Green Day. And you always give these kids the time of day, and you always make them feel special. And I know that, you know, each individual that you touch, it means the most. Like Tim from Sugar Cult used to say, part of our job is sitting at the merch booth and signing every single piece of merch that's bought if they want it to be signed. That's our job. And I want you to talk about what's it like, what's it like pushing through and giving these other kids, this next generation, the time of day? And also, what's it like being a dad and seeing this next generation grow up and seeing how your music is affecting them? Just talk about, I guess, you know what? What's it like getting older?
Yeah, I hate it.
don't we all?
I mean, it's one of those things like, because I have what we call like the Peter Pan syndrome, and I think once you enter into the world of music, you get older, but you don't feel older. You know what I mean?
Right.
Like, there are definitely different things that mentally I view differently now. I act differently now. There's certain things because I'm about to be 42 years old in fucking 2 days, you know? And so things are different, you know, you experience life.
Thank you.
You settle down a little bit.
And you know, I mean, I told everybody that today's my birthday, but tomorrow I turn 44, so I hate it.
Well, hey, happy early birthday. I'm a day after, it's over.
I appreciate it, man.
Go ahead. But yeah, I mean, I don't know. My thing is like these, because I am a fan, and I understand, like, it was awkward at first, and I had a hard time when in the early years of people talking to me and sort of viewing me or putting me up on a pedestal because it made me feel awkward. But then I had to remember that there are people that I look up to that I, in my brain, put on a pedestal. So I just had to remember, like, it is what it is. So you have to accept it. But then what I do in those moments is I try to then make them feel comfortable and talk to them like a human so mm-hmm. that it brings the conversation down to a normal level. And I mean, fuck, you made me think about that. The last time we worked together, there was a kid standing there that I talked to for a little bit, and he was telling me that his girlfriend just broke up with him and he's sad and all this shit. And we talked for a while, and I'm like, dude, you know, you're a good looking kid, don't worry about it, you'll be fine, this and that. Found out a week later the kid committed suicide.
Oh, Jesus, man. That's so terrible. So terrible.
You know what I mean? So in those moments,
you have to
remember that you just have to talk to people and give them a little bit of hope. Let them know people care. Life goes on. Things, you know what I mean? Like everything will pass at some point, you know?
And, right.
But yeah, I mean, I just, and I've met people too. Like I met Dave Grohl years ago, and
so
it
nice.
Was a bunch of us hanging out. It was like me and the Good Charlotte guys. And
yeah.
I remember Mike Durnt stopped me at a festival, and I remember he goes, hey, he's like, what do you say? He goes, are you in a band or you just look really cool? Because I like, you know, different colored hair and shit.
Yeah, right.
So we just started talking. We started talking about guitars and all this shit. And to the point where I had to stop the conversation. I was like, hey, I got to go to bed, man. I got to go up. I was like, I had to go up to my hotel room for something because I think not much time was there. But during that encounter, I met Dave Grohl too. And so when I said goodnight to everybody, I'm like, all right, I'm going to bed. Say goodnight to Ben. Say goodnight to everybody else. And I'm like, hey, man, nice meeting you. And I go up to Dave. And this is probably like 30 minutes later. And I go, hey, man, it was really nice meeting you. And he goes, nice meeting you too, Tony. And like, yeah, the fact that he
remembered your name.
Yeah, like I was like, that's one of the coolest things. Is how many people, and I'm not good at names. I'm really bad at that. So that was like a big thing. You'd be like, fuck, that was one of the coolest things that somebody like that could just, that small little thing of remembering that makes you go, man, like that makes that dude that much cooler. You know what
right?
I mean? Like, because of the position he's in, you know? And and, you know, a couple different times. I actually just on my Instagram posted some photos of me and I went and saw my friends in Lit last night at their record release show.
They're great. You know what? One of my favorite memories of Lit is me and the lead singer after the show sitting and watching a cover band play his song, singing along in the crowd, back to back, playing air guitar, while the band on stage is playing their song and we're in the crowd singing along. I love those guys. Lit are literally lit. Love those guys.
Yeah, they're just good dudes, and that was one of the first encounters too. It was in the early 2000s. We were on tour with them. We were doing like the side stage of the No Doubt Lit Black Eyed Peas tour, and we were able to get passes to go backstage every day through a friend that had worked with No Doubt previously, and instantly, like, all the people from No Doubt and Lit were just cool with us. Just took us in. They knew we were this young, new little fucking band. It was one of our first tours, and like, we'd play basketball with them. We'd drink with the Lit guys every day, and you know, it was a very short, maybe like a week long tour, and through that we just bonded with these guys. And then we'd play Anaheim and they wouldn't call us for tickets or anything. I would just look up in the balcony and they'd be there at the shows, you know. And I mean, it was that small little encounter. And then eventually later on, I wrote Kevin, the bassist of Lit, on fucking MySpace, and was like, hey, I'm starting a side project, I'm looking for a bassist, would you be interested? And he was like, yeah. So Kevin joined my band and we were in a side project together.
And what was the name of that band for anybody trying to look it up at home?
I think we were called The Permanent Holiday for a while.
Yes, you were called The Permanent Holiday. How do I know that? Because if you look it up, it's a blurb in your history.
Oh, well, there you go. But yeah, you know, like, I think that you just I like being genuine with people. And now, right. At least in an older age too, it's like you said about becoming a father, like, now when I'm talking to fans, it's like, you know, because you can go on my Instagram and see my kids and see what's happening in my, family life. And, you know, it's conversations about kids and real life shit and just having a normal conversation. And it's like, to them, I may not know them, right, but they feel like they know me.
Yeah.
You know, because they've been following my life for 20 some odd years.
Exactly.
And some of these people I do know from city to city. And it was like we were first hanging out as kids and we'd get drunk or they'd bring a joint or, you know, whatever. And
here it is 20
years later, they got a babysitter and they're hanging out, you know. And it's like, it's just, I mean, I just cherish those moments. And I am grateful for the fact that I still get to do this because not a lot of people do. And so, you know, it's just living in the moment and appreciating, you know, what I have.
You're absolutely right, and that made me think of a moment where I was walking down the street. You're going to get a kick out of this. Walking down the street with Steve Harwell, the lead singer of Smash Mouth, who I used to hang out with, and I started asking him about, because he had started using drugs again, so his album that he had been working on for like 10 years, I started to ask him about if he was finishing it, and he stops. We're walking down the street, it's just him and I, and he stops and looks at me, and he goes, are you asking me about music right now, dude? And I was like, yeah, I am. And he's like, seriously, are you asking me about music? And I was like, you're absolutely right. And the conversation just went back to, you know, whatever. Even though I was ultimately interested as a person and at the time as a friend, you know what? We don't need to talk about that because we're not those guys. This isn't a radio interview. You know, this is me and him walking down the street. And I, even though I'm interested in it and was asking from a genuine place, he doesn't want to talk about that with me. He wants to talk about, I don't know, whatever the hell we were talking about, but anything but that.
Well, because you talk about it so much, that's right. The thing that you'd rather just have a normal conversation, you know.
Well,
and don't get me wrong, like I don't mind people asking, like,
no, I know,
because they do want the new music and they're going to be the people that are buying and supporting it, so I don't mind it. But you know, I'll take a normal conversation any day over. I mean, I'll get those quick questions out of the way and let them know what's going on, because that's what they want to know. But yeah, I mean, eventually it's like normal conversations are definitely sought out more.
Well,
appreciated
I'm sitting there with the bass player of Hoobastank before a show, and we're talking about the Raiders or something, and he's from LA, and he just, we're talking about sports, right? And he just looks at me and he goes, you'll never believe what I used to do before I played bass in Hoobastank. And I was like, what do you mean? He's like, well, I'm from the Valley. And it didn't click. And I go, well, what the does that mean? I don't live in LA. What are you talking about? You're from the Valley. He goes, yeah, man, I used to be a cameraman for porn.
That's amazing.
And I look at him and I start laughing. He goes, not as cool as you would think.
Oh, yeah, I know. I've had friends tell me they've been on yeah, I'm asking for, and they're like, you know, if you go to a set and you watch it, they're just for you.
Yeah, it's definitely not as cool as you think. All right, we're going to say goodbye in just a little bit. I really do appreciate you spending all this time with me today. Before we get out of here, there's a couple things we got to hit. And when we say goodbye, I'm going to show the latest video, Masquerade, from the latest album, Masquerade. We've got all the links here. Let's drop some links on everybody. Please go follow and support the band on YouTube and check them out. If you're not familiar with the music, please do. When I drop off and Logan Radio goes live for the first time tonight, the very first song that I will be playing on Logan Radio tonight will be one of my favorite songs from one of my favorite bands. And it feels really weird saying this while he's here with us, but I will be playing Rooftops by Mast today to kick off Logan Radio. As of right now, it's basically just a glorified Spotify playlist. So you know what, Tony? You'll probably get about $1.06 more next month from Spotify, okay? And you can guarantee...
I appreciate that.
Yeah, not a problem, because Spotify really knows how to pay their artists. Hey, Spotify, get your head out of your ass and do something for the community. Seriously.
I mean,
it's absolutely insane. And don't even get Tony and I started talking about this, or the next thing you know, we're going to end up with a yellow card and our own record label or some shit. It's not out of the realm of possibilities, kids. Seriously, not out of the realm of possibilities. Next thing for me, Tony, I'm going to be moving out to Vegas, so we're going to get to get together real soon. And you know what? When I get out there, if you need a bus driver, I want to drive the bus, baby!
Oh, boy. I don't know about that, man.
Well, I haven't had a drink in 2.5 years, so I'm ready for it.
Then you might have the job. There you go.
Exactly. I quit drinking so I could quit smoking cigarettes, man. And you know what? We had done such a great job of drinking for all of these years, and since I wasn't smoking cigarettes, I just transferred. I did pull the Kevin Smith, and I just started smoking more weed. And you know what? I didn't miss it as much as I thought I would, and I'm a better person for it. We did a lot of really great drinking, and we've got a lot of really great stories around it. So now it's time to let everybody else have the stories, and I just kick back and do my thing. But before we get out of here, one thing I want you to do for me right now. And then we're going to talk about the video. Hey, back in the day, whenever you did a radio interview, they would want you to do station liners, which is a promo for the station, right? Now, we don't have that set up yet, but at some point we will. It's going to be called Logan Radio. So I want you to go back, take yourself back to literally 2002 and give me a Tony Lovato from Best Station Liner for Logan Radio, please.
Oh, you want me to do this like a 2002 one?
Yeah.
All right. What's up, guys? This is Tony from the band Mest, and you're listening to Logan Radio. If you have anything else to do, you should probably do that instead.
All right. Now give us grown-up Tony Lovato from Mest.
What's up, guys? This is Tony from Mest. You're listening to my boy Logan Radio. Make sure you support him. He's one of the good ones.
I appreciate that. Thank you so very much. All right, everybody. In 2002, you were 9 years old. Well, Joby One Kenobi, I don't want to think about that. Thank you so much for making us all feel so young and so old. All right, so now here we are. The pandemic hits, and, you know, the Mest has obviously changed over the years, but you want to put out music. You need to create some income as well. You're working on a music video, you're working on an album. How did all of this come together with you as working with the original members of the band to create the album? And where did the music video come from? Close this on out. You know how to do an interview. Do this for us, bud.
So I would say it was around 2018 that I started writing some songs for what was going to become a pop punk side project, essentially just what I would have written for like the Mess record, but just grabbing some other friends. Sorry, it was going to be a continuation. So I started writing a lot of songs, and one of my buddies who was playing bass for some tracks, after I'd written a couple tracks and he played on it, he was like, you know, he goes, these are Mess songs.
So, yeah.
I don't know, he goes, I just don't understand why you're not releasing it as Mess. And it was through a text message. And so I was driving at the time. And so I just started thinking about that question. And I was like, these are mess songs. Like, well, why would I not release it for what it is? And it was at that moment that I, you know, sort of was like, yeah, that's what this is. That's what it needs to be. So I just continued writing those songs. And I won't say that it was a 100% thing, but it was in my brain. Like, you know, it was there. And so I was like, you know what I'm going to do? I'm just going to keep writing and I'll see how this batch of songs turns out. And if it continues the way that it is, more than likely it's going to be a mess record. And that's what it was. You know, I ended up just writing for a couple of years, demoing a bunch of songs. And by the end of it, I was like, yeah, okay, this is a mess record. So I had played, I had done some tours and touring with my guys that I have now. But we had done some Mess original lineup shows, couple of them, like over 5 years. We're talking, we played like LA, or we played Anaheim once, Chicago a couple times because two of the guys still live there.
Right.
And one of them's in Detroit. But we weren't like touring, that was never gonna happen again. But I was like, you know what? It would still be cool for the fans if they play on the record.
Right.
And I was like, maybe it will present more opportunities to play more shows. Together. And so I hit the guys up and I said, hey, you know, I got this record written. I mean, it was done for the most part. And I was like, I think it'd be rad for the fans if you guys just fucking played on it, you know? And sent them all the songs. Everybody was down. And so, I mean, I was in the studio for about 2.5 months on my own doing most of it. But then they each came out for a weekend to play their parts. And we just fucking hustled through it and, you know, fucking made it happen.
Well, it's a great record. I mean, I really like where it's coming from.
Yeah, and you know, one of the things too, this is more back on the business part. I essentially did have a record deal through El Jefe from NoFX's label.
Yes, yeah.
And through communications while recording the record, and then we were done with the records being mixed, and I was out on tour supporting Real Big Fish in January 2019. Communications had slowed down a little, and I was like, you know, and me being in the business and running shit for 3 years since I had, I'm like, hey, what's going on with marketing? When are we going to start promoting this? When are we going to release the first single? All the questions that I essentially shouldn't have to ask.
Right. These should be presented to you in a portfolio in an exciting manner, right?
Right, right. And that communication wasn't happening as much as I wanted it to. And then I started thinking about it, and I'm like, I can do this in my own. I've been doing this in my own. And, you know, there's all these Kickstarters and different types of different things to run fan campaigns. And I just sort of started expressing that, like, you know, I wasn't sure I really wanted to do this. And it was nothing against them, but it was more of like, look, I got a kid to support, you know? And I would rather be in the driver's seat than in the passenger seat when it comes to my business and my life.
Well, it makes a lot of sense, and it brings me real quickly. I once asked you how I could get the rights to play some of your earlier music on this stream, and you said, to be honest with you, I don't even know who owns that at this point. So, you know, to actually be in control of your music at this age must have made a lot of sense for you. Sorry to interrupt. Continue.
Oh yeah, no, because like you said, every fucking dollar six that Spotify pays me, if somebody's taking 50% of that,
yeah,
you know, and then somebody's taking 10% and 15%, that adds up, and then when I'm getting my 25%, it, you know, I got to make a fucking living. So I just decided, you know, they said, hey, if you're not comfortable, you know, you can buy the record back, and I thought about it for a while and talked to somebody else, who I'm not going to say who, but they were like, this is absolutely what you should do. There's mm-hmm. nothing that they can essentially do that you can't do on your own being in the business as long as you have.
Especially nowadays, because the game has changed.
Right, right. And so, you know, through that label, we did have distribution through Sony Orchard Digital Distribution, a deal.
Well, you have to have some, yeah. I mean, you had to get on board with somebody.
Right, And so, luckily for me, the person that they go through over there happens to be a big Mess fan. So he found out that we weren't doing the record through them anymore. He was friends with my manager at the time. He reached out to him and said, hey, I'll happily get the Orchard on board to do this, which the Orchard normally just works with labels. But he was a fan, and he was like, I can get you guys a distribution deal if you still want to at least have it digitally distributed. So I was able to still do that, but then we turned to Kickstarter and raised way more money than they were offering. So we were able to record a bunch of videos, YouTube campaigns, and then through the Orchard Sony distribution, you know, they have the connections to Spotify to get you on proper playlists and shit like that. And you know what? To this day on Spotify, because I can go ahead and look at our account, the third most played song, all of our songs, is Masquerade.
Really? That's awesome. That's awesome. So, like, and I'm assuming Cadillac is number two. Cadillac's number one. Okay, all right. Well, that I thought you meant that Masquerade. And is the other one the song that we won't talk about?
Yes.
Oh, my God, dude. And we're not going to talk about it. We're not going to talk about it. If you want to know what that song is, just put yourself in his position and then find the the campiest, jokiest. Look, if Ashton Kutcher came out of that video, you'd be like, oh, all right, that makes sense. Thank you for that raid, Purple. We are here with Tony Lovato from Mess. And Tony, I just want to say thank you so much. It's been great catching up with you. I mean, you are a friend of mine, and I do appreciate you taking time out of your day to join us. And you know, we're gonna take a look at this video, and moving forward, I am gonna be playing a bunch of your music on the Logan Radio 24-hour music and stand-up comedy live on Twitch. When I'm not live, you can come here and check out music. And remember, you've got three vetoes, and with great power comes great responsibility. So you will change the way the radio station reacts with your vetoes. So be aware, everybody. And you only have so many of them. Every 20 hours, you only get three songs that you can skip. But that's the way that you interact. All right, Tony, is there anything that you would like to leave us with? I can't say thank you enough. I really do appreciate it.
Well, we do have new music coming out. I'm currently writing, recording the new record, which, just without being biased, like, I think this record's gonna be one of the best records we've ever done. The songs are fucking, they're great fucking good pop punk songs. Like, it's, I want to say they're like punk pop songs. When this record is going to be released, we'll do this again.
Oh, hell yeah, man. I'd love to do it again. And hopefully we'll be able to do it in person at a certain point. When I get out there in Vegas, we'll be able to see each other. This is my big thing for the year. And now once this is done, then I can focus on the esports side of everything. And also getting out there to Vegas. Because I've always had somebody be like, all right, it's a radio station. Like, all right, here's money. Now get your ass out here and we'll figure it out once you get here. Now it's like, hey, you got to spend your money to get out here and figure out what's going on. So it's always a little bit crazy, man.
Hey, just like the music business.
Oh, just dude, the music business, the radio business. Look, on the outside, they look so cool, and only a few of us get to do it. So, you know, it's great to do it, but you know, understand this. When I got into radio, I'm at $7 an hour. All right. Understand that. Now, granted, I got paid $100 an hour for appearances, and it starts to work itself out as you get to do more appearances. But look, and I've always said this about music. If it wasn't for local music, there would be no music. Literally, every band comes from somewhere.
Sure.
All right, Tony, thank you so much for being here. I appreciate you. Ladies and gentlemen, children of all ages, theys and thems, thank you so much. Tony Lovato from Mess. Cheers, buddy.
Later, bud.
All right, there you go. That is Tony Lovato from Mess. I truly do appreciate you coming by and saying hi. Let's get to the other side and let's look at the latest video from Mess. The latest video from Mess. It is Masquerade. He talked about it. And hold on one second. I'm figuring out my new setup here a little bit. All right, I gotta get. What do I gotta do here? I gotta get to. There we go. Let's get to live. All right, everybody, here you go. Without further ado, this is Masquerade by Mess.
Ryan Minty, 749 followed.
There we go, ladies and gentlemen. That is Masquerade by Mest. Oh my gosh, that's a good time right there. That is Masquerade by Mest. I hope you enjoyed it.